said a very good morning to you. I'm glad to welcome you to Morning Grill. It's that time every morning when we look at different issues that affect us as a people, as a nation, and we'll try to find a solution to it. We're trying to create the Nigeria of our dream. We're trying to focus on all the things that we see happening around us and bring in experts to talk to them, talk about them, hoping that we will keep working on ourselves, on our nation, until we all get it right for a better Nigeria. My name is Chinua Oguchumba. I'm your anchor on the program for this morning. And once again, thanks for joining us. The 2015 report from the WHO, the World Health Organization, says 63 million people do not have access to improved source of drinking water. About 75% of the urban population is actually served by improved water supply, but the rest of the population get their water from vendors. Some carry water from a very good distance after collecting them in open containers. Well, perhaps that describes your own experience. Others actually use water from wells and other conventional and non-conventional sources. And this period of the COVID-19 has also exposed the challenges of water supply. As a people, we actually need to wash our hands regularly with running water and soap, as instructed by the Nigerian Center for Disease Control and all other people involved in preventing and the fight of COVID-19. But the question so many people will ask is, how many people have access to water so they can effectively observe this? These and other issues are part of the things we're going to be looking at in a very short while. I have a guest who you get to hear him shortly. He is an urban and regional planner, a development specialist, former country director of Water Aid Nigeria. Okay, now let me leave all his profile and we'll take the special report. When we come back, you get to meet my guest, and then the program will also continue in earnest. So let's listen to the situation of water supply across different countries in Africa. Don't go away. The Panafricaine Conference for Female Journalists held in Casablanca, Morocco in March 2020. It had the theme, Climate Emergencies, focusing on how to mitigate climate change in Africa. The conference brought together female journalists from 54 African countries. The challenges of water was one of the areas of focus.
We have crisis, I can say it certainly, because you see young girls wake up at 4 or 5 a.m. just to get water. So now that the crisis here, it's coming, it's crisis time itself.
Asema James, she is one of the Pan-African journalists in Morocco. She is the station manager, Radio Democracy, in Freetown, Sierra Leone. Asema says Sierra Leone has one major source of water, the Goma Dam. It functions well in the rainy season, but in the dry season, supplies very little water for the population of Sierra Leone. People resort to buying water for their use.
We have Goma, it's called the Goma Dam, and now it's so small that it's really difficult to get water in Sierra Leone. Because when it rains, you see the dam is full, the barrels are of water. You pay up to like $40 if you have these private people, it's almost $100 to get the clean water. You know, they get water from all these bridges last for 2 weeks, so it's very expensive.
Sierra Leone is not alone in the challenges of water supply. Other African countries have challenges with water as well, though this might be related with the problems and effects of climate change. Nama Pumelani is from South Africa. She tells us what is going on in her country.
South Africa has been experiencing droughts in various parts of the country. You see places like the Peru in the Western Cape. We have the Northwest. We have Free States. And it's affecting our economy.
I am Christian Gary. I'm a journalist. I'm from Cameroon. I am a member of Comité Permanent des Panafricains. I take the case of my country. In Cameroon, I see Yaoundé. It's very hot. A lake of rain. Months of March, we have raining, but since there are rainy situations, there is not rain, and that is not good.
In Nigeria, the story is not entirely different. I spoke to Mrs. Chinyere Ono,
chair honor resides in two different cities, Abuja, the Federal Capital Territory, and Orumba in Anambra State. She has this to say.
I take bottled water. I buy it from the supermarkets. You can't compare Nigeria with other countries because we don't have taps all over Nigeria. For example, in Anambra, you don't have tap water there. Not only in Anambra, even in this Abuja, we don't have tap water all over Abuja. There are some people still using the well the outside people call Rijia. When they dug well, they take water from there and they drink from there.
Mr. Kennedy Uche is an entrepreneur. His factory needs water daily to survive. He says water supply has been relatively good in Abuja.
We get our supply from the board, the government supply. And it comes daily. It runs from 8 in the morning to about 10. It goes on until the next day, so you just have to store them in the reservoir. The water supply in Abuja here has been relatively good in the urban area, but much cannot be said in the rural community. Though in the FCT, some of the satellite towns too have water. It's only when you start going to the rural community. And that's when you have problem of water. And during this period of the lockdown, I've not really experienced shortage of water. They've been really doing well.
This sound of water is from the wastewater treatment plant of Medina, Casablanca, Morocco. This is an innovation of treating domestic wastewater using two technologies, the activated sludge treatment and the membrane technology. Hajar Note is a PhD student from Morocco. She explains the procedure of treating water.
It's a kind of filter, but with a very small size that remove all the bacteria or the organic pollution coming that bacteria cannot remove. We can use it only for irrigation or cleaning or washing machine, but not drinking water.
Hajra says research is also carried out to ensure the safety of the water before its use.
Yet we are trying to see the impact on the environment after years of using this water, and after that we can tell if we can use it for population or not.
This innovation can be replicated in Nigeria and other African countries as well. This can increase access to water for people. Asema James says governments in Africa can adopt the method of treating domestic water for use.
It's very interesting to see the way their domestic water has been processed, and I think it's something countries like ours should come and see. And I've seen, and I think I'll take the message back home to see how they don't actually waste water, and water they get from domestic, from their homes, it actually comes back here and then they recycle it.
If Nigeria alongside other African countries can adopt innovations like the wastewater treatment plant in Medina, Casablanca, Morocco, Africa can overcome lots of the water challenges it has and continue to be a great continent.
All right, you just listened to a report on the situation of water supply across some countries in Africa. Yes, I was actually getting you to be acquainted with the profile of my guest this morning. As I said earlier, he's an urban and regional planner, a development specialist, and former country director of Water Aid Nigeria. He was the global lead for urban water and sanitation at Water Aid UK for over a decade, before returning to Nigeria in 2016 to manage the USAID-funded Water, Sanitation and Hygiene Wash Coordination Project as Chief of Party. He is the managing partner of Mangrove and Partners Limited and consults for government, donors and INGOs. I have with me in the studio Timei Uwejamomere. I hope I got it.
Thank you very much.
Sorry, please can you help me pronounce it? Let me be sure of it. You know, earlier on I just saw Uweja.
Yes.
But this is the full name.
Yes, this is the full name. It's called Uwejamomere.
Uwejamomere. Okay. Yeah, Uweja thank Momere. You. Thank you so much. All right. Now let's, you listen to my report. Okay. I would have said maybe we'll pick some things, but having that in mind, let's look at the real situation of water in the country, you know, having that in mind, what are we looking at in Nigeria?
Thank you very much for inviting me to your program this morning, and I appreciate the time and the effort put into this process. I listened to your feedback from your meeting in Casablanca, and I think that it gives us a good, you know, flair of what happens across Africa.
Yeah.
We heard from Sierra Leone, Cameroon, you know, Nigeria, South Africa, Morocco, and that you know, represents the different facets of the state of water in Africa.
Yeah.
We also heard about mainly urban water, but we also got some feedback on, you know, satellite towns and rural areas in Africa. They talked to us about things to do with water resource management. They talked about treating wastewater.
Yeah.
They talked about how you source your water, whether you buy it or it's supplied to your homes.
Yeah.
You know, those are issues that we experience every day, and they are issues that are pertinent at this time for us as we talk about the pandemic. So we think that Nigeria is represented across Africa.
Yeah.
And the main challenges, like you said in your introduction, is that we do not have wide coverage of water services. You did say we have about 75% of Nigerians getting water, clean water from UN statistics. But in reality, that's not correct. The reality of the situation is that majority of our water is unimproved. Unimproved in the sense that they are taking, yes, we get water to drink, we get, you know, but then that water is not treated. It's water that people take from bottles without treatment. Some of them are not even tested after the bottles are constructed. We have water that is taken from ponds and from rivers.
Yeah.
We have water that is taken from shallow wells, from backyards. And don't forget that it's the same compound where you have your wells, that you also have your soakaway pits.
Yeah.
And the soakaway pits are not quite distant from most of the wells. We, in our minds, because we see that there's a fence between our walls, our compound wall and our neighbor's wall, we think there's a distance.
Okay. No, that's
in reality, your well may just be 2 meters, 5 meters, 10 meters from your neighbor's latrine. And as such, you know, there could be leachate leakage that could come into your wells. And so we have a lot of illnesses in Nigeria, and we don't know the source of them. We talk a lot about typhoids and malaria and things like that, waterborne diseases, cholera, you know, diarrhea. All of these things are impacted by these kinds of situations. And that's your urban experience. The rural experience is even worse than that. So effectively, we have a situation in Nigeria where we have not paid conscious attention to the fact that we need pipe-borne water to be able to supply safe water to a very large extent.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the countries where you have good health from water systems, 70-80% of them are already piped.
Yeah.
In fact, several countries have 100% piping, as it were. But in Nigeria, we only have 7% of piping. So we have our urban water systems having about 13%, and our rural having about 6-7%. So in average, you have a situation where less than 10% of Nigerians actually source their water from pipes. So effectively, the figures that we get, which says that 75% of us get water from the water corporations, I will question that figure.
Yeah.
Besides that, even if you get it so let's take Lagos for example.
Yeah.
We could say 50-60% of Lagos gets their water from the water board.
Yeah.
But perhaps only about 20% actually are connected to the water board. And what does happen? We have tanker drivers take water from the Lagos State system.
Yeah.
There are some fetching points or loading points for water tankers in Lagos that are formal and official, and there are several that are informal and you know, through the corruption, unofficial. So these tankers fetch the water. One, we do not know the quality of the tanker, if it's been treated, if they're safe. We do not have control over the water quality, therefore.
Yeah.
So the water gets home and is sold in jerrycans.
Yeah.
And it's taken away and put in drums. And you fetch from that jerrycan and drink straight. So effectively, you could have contaminated the water.
Yeah.
Either from the tanker or from the jerry can, or from the cup from which you are fetching it, from the pot or from the jerry can or the drums.
Yeah.
So we have that kind of situation in Nigeria that our water quality is in doubt, besides the fact that we don't have enough quantity of networked water. We also have challenges with water quality. So all of these combined together to give us a situation where we are under threat.
Yeah.
You know, beyond the water itself, when we talk about water in the sector, that's in the water and sanitation sector, we always want to talk about sanitation and hygiene at the same time.
Yeah.
Because I've just talked about fetching the water from the source and contaminating it through your jerry cans and through your cups. That's a sanitation issue.
Yeah.
And of course, that also has a bearing on hygiene, because if your cup is not clean because you have not washed it properly, or if your hands are not clean and you've put your hand in the jerry can or in the drums to fetch the water, or even holding onto the cup, you could contaminate that water that was treated. So we speak about those three together. But on their own, we have major challenges with sanitation and hygiene as well.
Yeah.
So only about 25% of Nigerians, actually 21%, wash their hands regularly. In fact,
not because of the COVID-19.
Not because of the COVID-19.
Okay.
You know, government statistics tells us that, you know, one in four of Nigerians wash their hands regularly. In fact, less than 10% of households actually know when to wash their hands, or heads of households.
Yeah.
So if the heads of the households do not know when to wash their hands regularly, how will they teach their children? So this is taking us now to education.
Yeah, and sanitation.
And sanitation education and hygiene education.
Yeah.
So we have situations where households, heads of households, fathers and mothers do not know when it's critical to wash hands. So pre-pandemic,
yeah,
we have situations where people actually are not practicing hand washing.
Yeah.
That's one. And then, of course, we know that you can only practice hand washing and make it an habit when you have water.
Yes.
So we need to be mindful of that. Secondly, we also need soap to be sure that the hand washing process itself is proper. So you need to know when to wash your hands, you need to have water, and you need to have soap. Unfortunately, most of our soap industry, or both the cottage industry and the big industry, are not as efficient, or have not penetrated the country as much as they should. We have soap in the urban area, and you need money to buy soap.
Yeah.
So several households cannot afford to buy soap. So people in the sector and the scientists amongst us have identified that you can even use other means of washing your hands, including using ash to wash your hands, you know, to clean it before you then run water over it. So there are ways of doing that. When I was growing up, we used to have people who make soap in our neighborhoods, in our villages. We used to have what they call soda soap.
Yes.
You know, we used to have sunlights. We were even taught in school how to make soap.
Yeah.
But I do not know if that still continues in our schools today.
I doubt that.
Exactly. So we have several facets of these issues that we need to unpack to be able to address the issue.
In fact, I think it's a bigger challenge than I even imagined and anticipated. Perhaps one needs to break these things down and identify or focus on them item by item, to be able to have a comprehensive understanding of the water and sanitation issues that we have. But let's look at this. When I was growing up, I lived in a home where you had water running up to your home, your toilets had water in them, your bathrooms, your kitchens and all that. And it seemed that was also the same practice, you know, across so many families. But now it's so bad. How did we get to this point?
How did we get to this point? That's a very pertinent question. We can ask the same question concerning our country. And I think that's the challenge that we've got. Our governance system has failed the country. We have a system where we listen more to things that happen outside of the country than the things that we need in the country. I'll tell you what I mean by that. Some time back, we had some economic crisis in the 80s, and we went to the World Bank and the financial institutions to get support. And one of the things they told us was to adopt a structural adjustment program. And one of the things that the structural adjustment program did to us was to stop to recruit people into the public service. So that's one of the first things. The second thing was that it advised government to stop to start collecting revenues from services, which of course is a great idea. But in practice, we did not do what we needed to do right. So you were taking away from the capacity to produce and you are charging people fees. The truth did not match. So you lost the capacity to produce the water and the services that you require.
Yeah.
And you are asking for people to pay. So when people do not get the service, they failed and stopped paying. Over the years, it's now about 30, going 40 years,
Yeah. People
are no longer used to what was that you refer to. So what then happened was that you've got utilities that were producing and selling water or delivering water to homes. At least some homes were paying. There were several water fetching points that were free.
Yeah.
Public taps, we used to call them those days. But then when you took out the capacity, in 5-10 years, people who knew and were there to mentor those who were coming behind were taken out of the system. They were not replaced.
Yeah.
So people were not, new staff were not coming in and being trained. The other thing that then happened was that when that then happened, people did not know how to manage the systems. So our assets were falling into disrepair. Both the urban assets and the rural assets were falling into disrepair.
Yeah.
And then we then had the challenge of not being able to provide the service, like I did mention.
Yeah.
But I think that we could have done it differently. And we could have done it differently by introducing systems where you had the private sector working with the public sector to ensure that the efficiency of the utilities are improved. We could have done it in a way that when we were going to ask for services, we were also paying for services, we were also making sure that people received services.
Yeah.
But then we didn't do all of that. So it took 20, 30 years for us to realize that public services were grounded. And one of the most affected that became, you know, unseen to people is the water sector or water utilities.
Yeah.
We know that all our state governments have water utilities,
but
all of these utilities are not adequately functioning. We could mention perhaps Lagos and one or two others, Abuja, that are producing water regularly and serving people.
Yeah.
But then the proportion of population covered in these two cities are also questionable. Yes, Abuja had a higher level of coverage, but Lagos coverage is quite low. And Lagos is frustrated by the size of Lagos.
Yeah.
To address some of these issues, the federal government has tried in time past to look at reforms. There have been several cycle of reforms.
Yes, we'll get back to the reforms that you're talking about. Now, let's also look at sources of making this work. We've seen what is going on in a country like Morocco, where they have a plant. All domestic water that the people use are channeled to this water treatment plant. And the water that is produced from the plant can be used for washing, for, you know, bathing and, you know, agriculture, so to say. Are you seeing these as other opportunities, or are there ways that Nigeria can, you know, things we can fall back on to say we can use them to address these issues?
Yes, we have things that we can use to address these issues. Let's take one step back. The water system in Nigeria is not homogeneous. Because we have three categories of settlements. We have the rural settlements,
yeah.
We have the semi-urban settlements or small towns, and then we have the towns or cities. For the rural settlements, we've adopted what we've called the rural water and sanitation supply systems, run by rural supply agencies. They use boreholes and hand pumps most of the time. Some of them have solar-powered pumps, but the majority of them do not have reticulated system. They only have water at one point. You go to a water point, you go there to fetch, and you take back home, which is adequate for a small town, 100 people, 50 people, 200 people. Sometimes we say one water point should serve 300 people within a distance of 30 minutes return home.
Yeah.
We also have the small towns that require reticulated systems, because then you are talking about perhaps population of 5,000 people or more.
Yeah.
And so you need some kind of reticulation to get this water to homes. For the rural and the small towns, the wastewater generated is not as much. So you can have some small systems of drain management, wastewater management. Small systems in the sense that it can go back into the underground water system if you channel them properly.
Yeah.
But we don't do that most often in Nigeria. But we also have the urban and the towns, you know, the big towns, the 10,000s and the 100,000s and the 1 million towns, or like Lagos, 20 million towns. There you need proper drainages, and you have need proper water pipes to get the water home, to homes. And for that purpose, we set up what we call the urban water boards. So that's why I said about we have about 7 of them. Each state and Abuja has one. They have various challenges, and I could discuss some of those challenges in time. But at the moment, we've said they struggle. So we now have only about 7-13% coverage from those pipes coming to homes.
Yeah.
So majority of our water systems actually come to us from water that we fetch ourselves, from our boreholes. So none of these things are reticulated.
Yeah.
The waste from them as such do not get reticulated as well. So to get our wastewater to a treatment plant, to recycle them for reuse, is a big challenge in Nigeria.
Wow.
Unlike what you saw in Morocco.
Yeah.
So it's almost non-existent. Statistics tells us that only about 5-10% of Nigerian wastewater from homes, industry, and drainage, or from storm water, that's rainwater, actually get back to a treatment facility, or get back into a proper drain to a treatment facility. Wastewater treatment is a good source of, you know, like you said, getting back water. But I think that the challenge we have in Nigeria today is not so much the wastewater itself.
Yeah.
You know, because what those countries like Morocco does is to channel wastewater and the toilet waste itself. So because when you flush your toilet, you are using 5-7 gallons of water, depending on design of your toilet faucets. Yeah. So they need that water and the waste to go to the same place. So they need to separate that waste from the water.
Yeah.
And people are turning that waste into something useful today. For us in Nigeria, I've just described the fact that we don't have a drainage system that links to a wastewater system.
Yeah.
But we still have our waste, our human waste, our feces. We call it what it is in the sector. And please mind my language. I know this is a radio station. But it's what it is. The shit from our homes get into a pit. And that shit is not shit. That shit is a resource. It's a resource that we can use in Nigeria. And there have been systems that have been practiced in other countries. Some Nigerian cities have them as well. For example, Enugu has a pond system that was introduced in the 1970s when some estates were built in Enugu. And we can use that system to treat the waste from human feces, separate the waste from the water, and return the water back for agriculture, to back into the channels of rivers. And we can separate the waste and use that waste as fertilizers.
Okay.
And use that waste as briquettes for fire.
Yeah.
And we use the gas from that process.
The biogas.
The biogas for cooking.
Yeah.
So there are so many things we can do with our waste that can generate a lot of money for us that we are losing out on in Nigeria. So effectively, we may not get back water as it is today because we don't have the drains, but we can have a system for collecting our fecal sludge and treating the fecal sludge and managing it in such a way that it can give us resources. It's a painful thing because we see a situation in the country where water sanitation particularly is losing ground and dropping fastly. In 1990, we were at 30% coverage for pipe water, 33% coverage actually for pipe water. Today, I'm telling you that we're at 7 or 13%. We are not quite agreed on the figures.
Yeah.
But, you know, government statistics is 13%.
It's going down.
It's going down. It's from 1990 to today, right? But we are losing money through that process as well. It's with A World Bank study says that Nigeria loses $455 million from that process, from not paying attention to water and sanitation. Through ill health,
yeah.
Loss of productivity,
yeah.
Loss of school days for children who cannot go to school, loss of school days for mothers, work hours for mothers who cannot go to work because they are taking care of sick children, and then the time and resources that we spend in treating children and those who have diarrhea in hospitals. So we focused on, curative medicine rather than preventative medicine. I remember very well Professor Onukoye Ransom Kutsi.
One time Minister of Health.
When it came, it turned around the Nigerian health system. You remember I said we pay more attention to things outside of our country than things that are relevant for our country. It turned around our health system and focused on primary health care. I wish that health ministers who have come after him have introduced even further, updates and reforms to strengthen our primary health care system, to strengthen prevention of of illnesses, right? And give us, the ability to be strong enough to be productive as a country. So that's one area that we don't pay adequate attention to in Nigeria, how to prevent illnesses. And you can only do that mainly from providing the right level of safe water, adequately managed or safely managed sanitation, and of course, hygiene education.
Okay, now you were actually going to look at some of the reforms that can be applied, in order for us to turn things around. All the things you've said, I kind of actually even feel overwhelmed with the situation. How can we get it right? And is it even possible to still get it right?
It is possible to get it right. And I'm very positive about that.
Okay.
I've seen work done by other countries. I've seen work done in Nigeria. And I know that it's possible to get it right. And I think that we're on the path. We just started a process as a country. The president, President Muhammadu Buhari, launched a national action plan in 2018,
yeah.
In November 2018. And that action plan sets out the roadmap to make this happen. A few things are critical within that roadmap. One of them is the fact that we need to start a campaign to end open defecation.
Yeah.
So 47 million Nigerians are currently defecating in the open. We need to stop that to ensure that we do not pass illnesses from feces to people.
Yeah.
That's one. We need to put in place a funding mechanism to make sure that the resources are there to support states and trigger these processes of change that we're going to talk about very, very shortly. To support states in the sense that states have been spoon-fed by the federal government on several fronts. There are states that are only generating about $100 million or $200 million every month. That's not even enough to write a state action plan.
Yeah.
Right? So talk less of putting in place the right structures and infrastructure. So we need to have the finance in place to do that. Besides that, we need to have the governance system that will help us. This is where the reforms are coming in now. The governance systems that will help us. Governance system talks about the systems by which you bring everybody together to plan and to implement a process that gives you order in your country or in any sector.
Yeah.
So we need to be able to have people who can participate and own the process of participation and know that what development is about is for themselves, not for somebody else. We need to have a way to have duty bearers accountable to the citizens to ensure that when you say we are going to do X, Y, Z, at the end of 1 year or 2 years that you have said you will do X, Y, Z, somebody will ask you, which of the X and Y and Z have you attended to?
Yeah.
And what have you achieved by doing that? We need to have a regulator. We will ask you questions as to, this is the standard that we expect in the country. What are you delivering? Why are you not meeting those standards? Or why are you not, attending to the targets that we've set for you?
And then, of course, if you are not delivering, you either fined or you are fired.
Yeah.
You know, so there's accountability, as it were. We also need to have the systems that the utilities themselves require, either the water agencies, the small towns unit, or the urban water board. And those systems include, you know, policies and laws that will clarify rules for everybody. They require institutions themselves. So at the local government level, we need to have what we call the water and sanitation units that can help us to supervise the activities of delivering the services and the infrastructure. At the state level, we've talked about the rural water agencies. At the small towns level, we talked about the small towns unit. And at the city and urban areas, we talk about the water boards. But each of these units have some gaps in their systems.
Yeah.
Those gaps include, like I mentioned before, the capacity challenges that were there. So we need to train people. If you go to Nigerian universities, colleges of technology, colleges of education, secondary schools, the curriculum is not clear for how to build and provide services for water and sanitation.
Yeah.
We have engineers that are trained. They are not, most universities don't train sanitary engineers in Nigeria. We have sociologists that do not know that they could be part of the process for socializing for change to deliver water and sanitation services.
Yeah.
We have scientists, microbiologists, different kinds of scientists who actually have not paid attention to the fact that their services are required when it comes to water quality, waste management, and things like that. We have planners who do not know that their job includes planning for water and sanitation in their cities, not just demolition of buildings.
Yeah.
So we need to reorientate our educational system and direct young people and even people who are currently in training or in service towards a focused attention to delivery. Like I told you before, we also need the numbers of people to be on the seats to deliver these services. All of this I'm talking about require funding.
Yeah.
So funding to build capacity and funding to put the infrastructure in place. It is calculated that we require about $1.3 to $2.5 billion. So that's about it's the kind of money that we can afford as a country.
Okay.
But then we will put our attention there. We would rather fund treatment of sicknesses or rather than fund things that could prevent illnesses. We also need to be sure that, you know, like I did mention, we have control and are able to manage our water resources properly.
Yeah.
So you talked about dams, the Goma Dam in Sierra Leone. We've got about 230 dams in Nigeria. Several of those dams are underused.
Yeah.
We've got dams and treatment facilities put in place by the federal government in some states. Through a relationship between the states and the federal government that were agreed before those dams and treatment facilities were put in place, the government was supposed to put pipes from the treatment facilities to the towns. The state governments failed. So we've got a few of those in some states that are not producing services at the moment. So we need to have a change of orientation. That's why I say reforms need to come in, accountability processes need to come in. You know, we also need, of course, to have a sense of planning for either a village,
yeah,
or a town or a district, whichever one we are attending to at the moment. What we've done so far is that we focus on projects. We have not seen our towns and our cities and our rural areas as systems that must operate together.
Yeah.
We need to bring that town-wide or district-wide sense of planning and delivery into the activities that we do. Like you said, all of this may sound, you know, quite cumbersome and difficult to attend to, but they are not. It's not rocket science.
Yeah.
It's been done in several countries.
And
we can replicate it. We can do it. We've got some success stories, so it's not all bad stories.
Yeah,
states like Jigawa, Katsina are doing great, particularly with rural water services.
Okay.
We've got support from donor partners and international NGOs like UNICEF, like WaterAid, helping the country and helping communities. We've got WSSCC working through United Purpose. So if I could give you some of the examples of good successes, you know, we in Cross River State or across the country up until 2017, no community, no local government in Nigeria was open defecation free. So, meaning that everybody in that local government area was using a toilet. You know, like I said, we're doing project-based approach. So when WaterAid introduced what is called community-led total sanitation to the system in Nigeria in 2004-2005, it was all project-based. Over time, that changed to district-wide approaches. So people now focused on how do we make sure that a local government is open defecation free. UNICEF and United Purpose are particularly focusing on regions in Nigeria at the moment. Cross River State, Obaniku, was the first local government, Obaniku local government in Cross River, was the first in 2017 to have a local government-wide open defecation-free community. Okay. At the moment...
That's quite interesting.
Yes, Obaniku was the first one. And based on that, we've had several others, local government, that have been able to achieve open defecation. But then we just have only about 24. I remember we have 774 local governments as at today. That's a far cry. But, you know, states like Katsina, Jigawa, Benue, Cross River are making good success. But then we need the governors of those states to come to a position where they will say, well, what is my rural agency doing? Can my state become the first state to achieve statewide open defecation free states?
Yeah.
For that to happen, we need the state governors to push. And we know in Nigeria, when one person achieves something, every Nigerian wants to achieve it.
Yeah.
So it would be my joy if we find a governor, Cross River, Katsina, Jigawa, Benue, Bauchi. Those five states are at the forefront at the moment. They've got three local governments amongst this list of 27.
That's quite interesting.
Yes. But these ones can provide the platform for these states to become competitive and race to the finish. We need that to happen. Between now and 2022, 2023, because if we do that, then the target of the National Action Plan to achieve open defecation by 2025 will be achievable.
Yeah.
You know, mind you, the National Action Plan, I didn't mention, sets a target for 2030 for every Nigerian to achieve open defecation, to achieve safe water systems and safely manage sanitation.
So in wrapping up, what would be your final words for someone who's listening this morning?
I think my final word, if we're looking at this from the perspective of the pandemic, is that we as citizens of this country must ask our leaders to give us water, because without water we can't wash our hands.
Yeah.
Even if the medicines come and the vaccines come, we still need to be able to wash our hands to prevent another episode of this nature.
Yeah.
We need to keep social distancing, as it's been said. We need to use our mask. But you know, if we don't have clean water, there are several sources of contamination. You know, yes, we could use sanitizers, or you cannot sanitize your fruits. You cannot sanitize many things that comes into your mouth.
In fact, even the waters, there was a day I did a report from, sorry for cutting you short there, a community in Papi, inside Abuja here, where their source of drinking water, cooking water and drinking water, is a small stream. Over the years, according to them, the stream had actually shrunk. It's just remaining a little patch of water that runs. And people bathe, wash their hands, wash their clothes, drink the same
water. The animals probably use the same water.
Right there in front of me, you know, the guy that was drinking for me actually scooped water and drank the water straight. I was like, this is what we have been living on. This is what has been sustaining us over the years. And one would imagine this is quite a dangerous thing.
It sure is.
Okay, we're actually having so many calls now, but we're not able to take them. But let's say, maybe when we'll bring you next time, we'll look at other opportunities where people can integrate and, you know, come on board in this system, because our time is already far gone.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I've had with me in the studio, he's an urban and regional planner, development specialist, and former country director of WaterAid Nigeria. He was the global lead for urban water and sanitation at WaterAid UK for over a decade before he returned to Nigeria to manage the USAID-funded water sanitation and hygiene wash coordination project as chief of party. Thank you so much, Timei. Thanks for coming on the program.
Thank you very much, Inye. It's okay. A pleasure speaking with you.
And I hope when next to call you, you will oblige us.
I'll be very glad to do so.
All right, let's do this same time tomorrow. To have yourself a great day.